morning we'll be discussing groin hernias. It's quite a lengthy topic, so brace yourselves, and my apologies to the orthopods. As always, this talk comes accompanied by a paper that goes into a lot of the work in a lot more detail. If you would like that paper, you can just ask me and I'll email it to you. So we'll be discussing groin hernias under a couple of headings. We'll be looking at some statistics, sort of a brief overview of the anatomy of the area, how we diagnose the condition, some classifications systems, indications to treat groin hernia, and then we'll have a look at some treatment options and the complications thereof. Okay, so just looking at some numbers. The true incidence of groin hernia is not clear, but the repair of these hernias forms a large bulk of modern-day surgical practice. Inguinal herniorrhaphy is probably the most commonly performed procedure by general surgeons, with about 750,000 hernias being repaired in the United States each year alone. Patterns of repair are not the same worldwide, as you can see by that graph. About 3 times more hernias are repaired per million members of population in the United States compared to the United Kingdom. So some anatomy. All medical students will spend many hours studying the anatomy of the inguinal canal, and many will never remember all the finer details of the complex three-dimensional area. Moreover, even those of you who have very good book knowledge of the area and can name all the structures off by heart will probably find yourselves quite stumped when you open an actual groin of an actual person. And you'll realize that no diagram or picture can truly convey what the surgeon encounters. So in this talk, I'm not going to go into a detailed discussion of all the groin structures because that's just something you have to sit down and study, but we'll rather discuss some of the concepts you need to grasp about the groin in order to understand hernia. So inguinal canal, this here is Nias's diagram of the inguinal canal, which is about 4 centimeters long and located about 2 to 4 centimeters above the inguinal ligament and carries the spermatic cord of the round ligament. So like any passage, it has 2 walls, a floor and a roof, and it starts at the deep ring, which is a defect in the transversalis fascia and which forms the posterior wall, and then it ends at the superficial ring, which is a triangular opening in the aponeurosis of the external oblique, which forms the anterior wall. Okay. And I only read about Fouchard's myopectineal orifice for the first time when preparing for this talk, but understanding of this area is useful in the understanding of the anatomic location of various groin hernias. So Fouchard advocated that all groin hernias originate in a single weakened area of the abdominal wall, and he described the MPO in the 1950s. It's bound inferiorly by the Cooper's ligament, which is on the bony margin of the pelvis. Its superior margin is formed by the inguinal scythe, which is in turn formed by the internal oblique and transversus abdominal muscles. Then its medial border is rectus abdominal, and its lateral border is iliopsoas. It's divided into a superior and inferior orifice by the inguinal ligament. So inguinal hernias occur through the superior orifice, and femoral hernias occur through the inferior femoral orifice. Yeah. So superiorly passes your inguinal canal, and inferiorly passes your femoral vessels. Okay, so I'm not going to go bore you all to tears with detail about the various nerves and vessels, because once again, you just need to sit down and study it. But they are important structures to remember, and when you're doing a groin hernia repair, it is actually quite important to dissect out and to try and preserve nerves. If you damage them inadvertently, you can cause chronic groin pain, and if you accidentally damage vessels, you'll cause bleeding, which can be anything from irritating to catastrophic. So when you're diagnosing a hernia, it's actually quite a simple affair. A bulge in the groin is the most common complaint and common presenting sign. And there may be pain or associated paresthesia, but they're not usually extremely painful until they become incarcerated. So clinical examination is the most important part of the diagnosis of inguinal hernia, and is usually all that is required in simple and complicated hernias. So you should examine your patient supine and erect, and a finger should be placed into the internal ring, and the patient should be asked to perform a Valsalva to feel if there's a bulge coming through the ring. A bulge above the inguinal ligament is usually an inguinal hernia, and below the inguinal ligament is usually a femoral hernia. You can do some special investigations. So ultrasound is very sensitive and specific for groin hernias, and it's good at differentiating between inguinal and femoral hernias. then ultrasound, CT and MRI are good for eliminating other causes of an inguinal mass or of pain. So there is a differential diagnosis to an inguinal swelling, which you guys can have a look at. And then herniography, not something we use here or that has been encountered ever, and not something that's really discussed much in the literature, is injection of the contrast medium into the peritoneal cavity, followed by a plain film, which shows your peritoneal folds and reflections and shows a bulge. So in very tricky cases where you're really not sure if you've got a hernia or something else, laparoscopy can be diagnostic and has the advantage of being therapeutic as well. And then how accurate are we when we're diagnosing hernias? We're very good at diagnosing a groin hernia, and we're not so bad at differentiating between inguinal and femoral hernias. But the studies have shown that we're pretty bad at differentiating between a direct and an indirect hernia. And in most centres, according, you know, even specialist versus intern, our accuracy rate is probably less than 50%. And the question is, does it really matter? Probably not, because we repair the hernias the same way. Okay, so classification systems. We do still refer to groin hernias as being either direct, indirect, or femoral, but these descriptions are quite simplistic and don't adequately describe what is actually happening within a particular hernia. So there are several more complicated classification systems that have been proposed, and although they are seldom used in day-to-day practice, their true value is in theory supposed to lie in the fact that it gives us a standardized way of comparing groin hernias, which is useful when we're doing studies to compare different repair techniques to each other. They give more detailed descriptions of the hernia size, of the state of the internal ring or the posterior wall, and make allowances for things such as pantaloon hernias, which is a hernia that has a direct and an indirect component, and recurrent hernias. So the classification systems are described in quite a lot of detail in the paper, but we'll just go over it quickly. The NICE classification was proposed by Chicago surgeon Lloyd NICE in 1991, and it's based on anatomic criteria and focuses on the functional state of the internal ring and the posterior wall. And he proposed specific hernia repairs for different hernia types. Then the Gilbert classification, with additions by Ratko and Robbins, is based on anatomical and functional defects found intraoperatively and requires some variables such as recurrence to be noted separately. And then Ratko and Robbins use mesh plugs for all of their repairs, but we'll discuss more about that later. Okay, the Ben David classification, Dr. Ben David works at the Shoulders Clinic, and it's a fairly complicated classification, and each hernia is given a TSD score, T standing for type, referring to anatomic location, S referring to the sac and how large it is and where it is, and D referring to the diameter of the defect. And then the GREPA, the ARSHIN, and the European Hernia Society are also good scores, but they all sort of, when you really look into them, modifications of each other. Okay. So traditional teaching has it that all inguinal hernias must be repaired, as they will enlarge over time and become more difficult to operate, and they're associated with serious complications. But numerous recent studies have brought this thinking into question, as surgeons begin to question the true natural history of groin hernia. There are absolute indications to repair a hernia, such as incarceration or strangulation or bile obstruction, and pain is also an indication to repair. However, not all hernias are painful, and in asymptomatic hernias, is it acceptable to watch and wait? So if you look at hernias, if you look at the life-threatening complications, which are things like bile obstruction and strangulation, they're actually quite rare. The chance that a hernia will become irreducible increases with time, but over 12 months, the probability that it's going to happen is only about 6.5%, and over 10 years, it's only 30%. Okay, and then data obtained from Paul Berger's Trust Clinic, which is a 19th century hernia clinic in Paris, and from some population studies done in Colombia in the 1970s, show that the lifetime risk of bile obstruction or strangulation, which is the most life-threatening complication, is only around 0.3% for an 18-year-old male, and as little as 0.03% in a 75-year-old male. And then also with improved post-operative care, mortality from these complications has plummeted. In Colombia in the 1970s, the mortality following obstruction was around 47 deaths per 1,000, but here and his colleagues had a series in 2000 that showed almost no deaths, which I think is probably in keeping with what we are finding even in our institution, where patients present quite late. In the large studies, which we'll get to now, the causes of death following hernia operation included things like cerebrovascular accidents and myocardial infarctions, and it's debatable whether or not the hernia was truly the cause of these complications. Okay, so these are the two large studies that looked at whether or not we can act in a more conservative fashion when it comes to hernia. And both of these studies randomized males with inguinal hernia into an operative and a watchful waiting group. So O'Dwyer and his colleagues, two-thirds of the observational group recorded rest pain at involvement, but this dropped to around a quarter or 25% after about a year without intervention. And then just over a quarter of the observational group crossed over to surgery because of increase in hernia size or pain. And then of note is that at 6 and 12 months, there was no significant difference in pain scores between the observational and the operational group. There were three serious adverse events in the observational group. So one was an incarceration, which was reduced and then repaired electively. Whether or not that's a serious event is debatable. And then one patient died of a cerebrovascular accident, another one of a myocardial infarct. Their argument for saying that this was a serious complication of waiting was that if the patient had been operated earlier, their metabolic disease wouldn't have been as far advanced, so they wouldn't have died from their operation. But a side argument is that they were given a six-month reprieve from their ultimate fate. Okay. Then Fitzgibbons and colleagues also found that at 2 years, there was no significant difference between the quality of life and pain scores between their observational and their operational groups. So that leads us to conclude that watchful waiting is a safe option for patients who are not troubled by their symptoms. If a patient does have pain, an operation will probably improve it. But if a patient doesn't have pain, you must remember that chronic post-operative groin pain is a complication of a repair, and you might end up having a patient who had more symptoms than what they did in the beginning. There is one exception, of course, which is femoral hernias, which are far more likely to strangulate than inguinal hernias because of the nature of the anatomy in that canal, and those should be repaired as soon as possible after discovery. So when you're looking at repair techniques, because there are many, the ideal repair should have low recurrence, few complications, it should be easy for all surgeons to perform, it should not be too expensive. There should be a short hospital stay and convalescence period, and your patient should be able to return to work quickly. There's no single correct technique, and as a surgeon, you need to acquaint yourself with the literature, and which you need to read with some cynicism. As many authors, you'll see when you read the papers, many authors will advocate a single repair as being the best repair in the world. But many of these authors have vested interests. For example, Rathko and Robbins have written a paper, a very nice paper about the mesh repair. But you must remember that they helped to develop the perfect mesh plug, which they advocate using. Repairs can be broadly divided into a couple of categories. So there's more detail in the document describing the repairs and also some recommended reading. We're just going to discuss the broad principles here. There's tissue repairs. There's tissue and there's mesh. And then in mesh, there's open and there's laparoscopic. In your open repairs, you get anterior repairs, you get plug repairs, preperitoneal repairs, and combination repairs. And then the laparoscopic, they're all preperitoneal repairs. There's a difference between if you enter the peritoneum first or if you cleave a space before starting your repair. So the Scholdice repair, those of you who are in medicine for the money should take a look at the Scholdice business model because it's quite fascinating. So this is a tissue repair that was pioneered in the 1930s by Mr. E.E. Scholdice, or Dr. E.E. Scholdice, sorry, as part of his war effort. He noticed that quite a few recruits were being turned away from the army because of their groin hernia and not being allowed to go to war. So as part of his war effort, he repaired their hernias for them so that they could go off and serve their country. This clinic is based in Thornhill near Toronto, and at their clinic, their recurrence rate is only 0.6%. However, this is a complicated repair, and surgeons at the Scholdice clinic are supervised for their first 200 repairs. So it's not very surprising that surgeons outside of the Scholdice clinic do not have the same results. Nevertheless, it still has a lower recurrence rate than other tissue repairs, such as the Pacini or the McVeigh. Then the Liechtenstein, in my experience, this is the most commonly used repair in this part of the world. Most of the registrars rotating through that use this, and it's also what I've always used up until now. It's an anterior repair where mesh is placed over the posterior wall deep to the external oblique aponeurosis. It seems to be considered as a kind of a gold standard, and in most of the literature is comparing the efficacy of repairs. They use the Liechtenstein as a control. Okay, so the plug and patch repair, not something I've ever really seen being used here. The idea of inserting a plug was first described by Arthur Gilbert, who used to hand roll a cigar-shaped mesh or an umbrella, sort of reduce his sac, put his plug through the internal ring, and then sort of allow it to deploy in the extraperitoneal space. Then Rutko and Robbins also use a plug technique. It's slightly different in that they don't deploy a mesh into the extraperitoneal space, but rather insert a preformed umbrella-shaped mesh into the ring, and then they also put a patch over that. And they go to great lengths to explain why this is not an anterior or Liechtenstein repair, it's a plug repair. And the patch, they say, only serves to prevent the formation of other hernias. So your plug repairs the hernia you've got now, and your patch stops you from getting another direct or indirect hernia later. Okay, and then the mesh repair, the preperitoneal operation. So I couldn't find a good picture of what this looks like when it's done. This is a picture of Lloyd Nias, who we've mentioned a couple of times in this talk so far, in the anatomy and in the classification systems. So he described the Nias preperitoneal operation. He was head of the surgical department at the University of Illinois and Chicago campus. He died in 2008 after making numerous contributions to different aspects of surgery. So basically, this involves an incision slightly higher than your traditional incision for your Liechtenstein repair, and you enter the preperitoneal space through the transversalis fascia and then deploy a large mesh between the peritoneum and the transversalis after dissecting out all the hernias. Okay, and then the proline hernia system. This is a preformed mesh system that sort of covers all of your bases. It's got a component for the preperitoneal space, a plug, and then an anterior flap. I've never personally seen this myself, but John tells me that this is what he used all the time when he was in private. Okay, and then just a very quick note on laparoscopic procedures. There are two kinds. The TEP is the total extraperitoneal repair, where you enter, you take your first port under the umbilicus, you insert it, and then you usually use a balloon to clear the space between the peritoneum and the transversalis fascia before inserting your other two ports and deploying a mesh into the space. In a transabdominal preperitoneal repair, or a TAP, you enter the peritoneum, then you open a flap of that and go into the extra peritoneal space, insert your mesh, and then close your flap again afterwards. Okay, so which repair is best? And we can look at a couple of complications, and mostly we look at recurrence and pain. So we'll start with recurrence. So basically, mesh always wins when it comes to recurrence, and they have less recurrence in tissue repairs unless you have your repair done at the shoulder clinic, in which case they compare fairly evenly. Recurrence is low in both open and laparoscopic techniques, although there is some evidence that the incidence of chronic pain is lower in laparoscopic repairs. Then we can look at time and money. If it's important to you how quick your operation is, a plug will win you a couple of extra cups of coffee a day. Although as you become more experienced at the shoulder ice or the open or the laparoscopic repair, the differences become less. Laparoscopic surgery is more expensive at the time of surgery, but in theory the costs even out as patients who have undergone a laparoscopic repair can possibly return to work slightly earlier than other ones. And then we look at sort of complications of the repair other than pain. Pain is in the slide as well. So intraoperative events include things like visceral or vascular damage. And these are they're very rare, but slightly more common in laparoscopic techniques. And usually it's the bladder that's injured. Then other complications like infections, seromas, hematomas, and so forth seem to be evenly distributed across the different kinds. Recurrence is the most common in tissue repairs and equal in laparoscopic and open repairs. Only a few studies have compared different open repairs to each other, and it seems recurrence is evenly distributed across the kinds of open repair, although there is some evidence to show that the proline hernia system has a slightly lower incidence of recurrence. But once again, the literature needs to be read with some cynicism to look at, you know, what your author's interests are. And then, like I said, chronic groin pain seems to be less in patients undergoing laparoscopic repairs. Then looking at infection rates, wound infection is extremely rare in elective repairs and increases to about 12% in emergency repairs. And most of these infections occur when there was strangulated bowel requiring resection. And there's no evidence that any kind of antibiotic prophylaxis, be that enteral, parenteral, or soaking the mesh in some kind of a solution, makes any difference to your post-op either tissue or mesh sepsis rate. Okay, then chronic groin pain. As hernia recurrence sort of becomes more negligible and we become better at doing hernias and our recurrence rate drops to almost zero, the new hot topic is chronic inguinodynia. So some studies suggest that chronic groin pain after hernia repair may be as high as 53%, and this may be caused by neuroma formation after damage during surgery or by entrapment of a nerve by a suture or a tack. Mesh has not been shown to make any difference to groin pain. And there are various treatment options. We'll go into a little bit more detail in the paper, starting with simple analgesia. You can send the patient to a pain clinic for a regional block. And then some people actually advocate a neurectomy where they cut off all the nerves and bury their stumps. And then you should also exclude other causes of chronic groin pain. And a big risk factor for chronic post-operative groin pain is pre-operative groin pain. And Rutko and Robbins actually claim that there is no such thing as post-operative groin pain, that it was all patients who had another problem beforehand. Okay, then which repair should you choose? You should familiarize yourself with multiple repairs, but you should try to be a master of one. And the chosen repair should be relevant to your setting. So for example, it's no use becoming a master of the proline hernia system at USTA. If your chosen repair is an anterior repair, it's useful to have a backup extraperitoneal repair for treating recurrences and vice versa. And you should always have a tissue repair in your repertoire for those cases where it's unsafe to insert a mesh because you've had to resect bowel, for example. Okay, so basically a final word. There are lots of groin hernias out there. They don't all need to be fixed. The techniques available work well, and there are many of them, and then complications are few and far between. Any questions?